Hi, I'm Bob Gwynne, and we're here at the National Railway Museum, and today we're going to have a look at Mallard. Okay, this is Mallard. It's built in 1938, and it's a London North Eastern Railway A4 Pacific locomotive. So thanks to this magic stick in front of me, we're going to have a much closer look at Mallard today and find out more about it. Well, Mallard, apart from a beautiful shape and it's this beautiful colour, of course, you know, is very famous for being the fastest steam locomotive in the world. 3rd of July 1938, this locomotive attained a world speed record for steam traction of 126 miles an hour. Well, we're going to talk about that record because it's an interesting story. In 1938, steam was still king in the UK, but fundamentally, what you've got is rivalry between the two big railway companies in Britain at that time, with Mallard from the London and North Eastern Railway, and then Duchess, which is from the London, Midland and Scottish Railway. And what happened was that Sir Nigel Gresley, who was the chief engineer of the London North Eastern Railway, he was in conversation with a fellow called Norman Newsom, and he said to him, what do you reckon? Can we beat the LMS? And Newsom said, well, I reckon we can. So what they did was they got a real whip-hand driver called Joe Duddington, who was 61, and his fireman Tommy Bray was big muscles, and they got an inspector called Sam Jenkins, and they set off with the train, and that was it. Off you go. As you can see from the outside of it, it's a beautiful streamlined shape. It's been formed in a way that makes it cut through the air very smoothly. They developed the streamlined shape in a laboratory where they had a plasticine model of this kind of engine. And the problem was that the smoke was not lifting from the chimney and it was drifting over where the driver and fireman would sit. One time they put this plasticine model into the smoke chamber to blow some smoke over it and see what happened. All the smoke started to lift, and what they discovered was that somebody had put a thumbprint accidentally behind the chimney, and that slight depression created a vortex that lifted the smoke clear of the cab. And that thumbprint is there to this day on Mallard. So Mallard's full of interesting secrets, really, and really what's important about it is what you can't see. It may be streamlined on the outside, but on the inside, the cylinders here, there's three sets across the engine, and it's been designed so that there's no back pressure, so that you can go as fast as you possibly can with it. What else can we see on the outside? Well, because it's streamlined, there's a few things that are a bit more difficult. So the front end here, you've got to actually open that up to get any char and thing that's come through the tubes. To open it up, you actually need a key. The key goes in here. You wind that up and it opens the flap up so that you can basically get any of the rubbish that's come out from the fire up to the chimney and ended up in that space out so that the locomotive works correctly. There are a couple of other things, because of course it's streamlined. You've got to oil all the different bits on it. So it's actually got the oiling points are actually, there's a little sort of door. You have to open the door to get into where you oil the motion, because every little moving part, you know, it's all going to require oil on it. Down here, you've got the thing that puts sand under the wheels that allows the wheels to stick a bit better on the rails if you have a problem with wet rails. Because don't forget, the contact patch on a locomotive is only really the size of a thumbnail on the wheel. It's a tiny amount. So why is it called Mallard? Well, when this was built, Sir Nigel Gresley lived in a house that had a moat around it. There's a picture of him feeding these ducks. And a number of these locomotives were named after birds. So there's a Mallard, there's an Osprey, and so on. So it's just basically a nice name, and it suggests something going swiftly through the air. I think it's probably a good time to have a look on the cab of the locomotive and just have a look at what Joe Duddington did on that day in July 1938. Now, this is a view a lot of people don't get. You get people peering in through the window to have a look, but we're very privileged now because we're in the cab. Let's have a look at how this machine works. Let's start off with the most important bit, which is a very, very large fire, which is in there. A ton of coal burning very white hot. I mean, here's some coal, you know, a ton of that burning white hot in there. And you've got a fireman. Fireman with his shovel. There's his shovel. What he's doing is he's firing, in L&ER terms, over the flap. He's firing in there, and he's got to get coal into the corners of the firebox on both sides, right to the back. The fire in there would be so hot, that's why there's kind of baffle plates here to protect the driver sat here so that the heat doesn't get to him. So he's responsible for that. He's responsible for keeping the water levels. This shows you how much water there is in the boiler, and the water level would be sort of 3/4 of a glass, sort of up here to up here. And really, his controls are put the water into the boiler and keep the fire glowing absolutely white hot. The driver's on this side, and what he's got three main controls. He's got his regulator, which is basically what lets power go into the machine. You know, it's a thing that lets the steam go from the boiler to the cylinders. So it's, if you like, it's like the accelerator. On this one, it's kind of beautifully sculpted. It's got that sort of curved end to it. So it, you hold it really nicely. And then he's got his brake, very important. And the brake, this shows you how much brake he's got on. He should be on 21 inches of mercury up here when it's running. Steam chest, pressure gauge. This would be changing as you went along based on the steam in the cylinders. The actual steam gauge up here, right round red mark, 250 pounds per square inch. You'd really want to see it round on the red stop, as close to the red stop as you can, because that's giving you the maximum amount of steam to use in the machine. And he's got his reverser down here, which the reverser is the thing that basically gives you full forward gear, and then you can adjust it. So you can, you're using less steam going into the cylinders. That's fundamentally the driver's controls. Behind us, of course, we've got a few other things. In here, you've got a coal space. So the coal space, all of that would be coal. And underneath it in the tanks is water. And of course, best of all, you've got this shelf, which you keep your oil cans on there so the oil remains viscous. But of course, you can also keep your billy can on there so you've got hot tea at all times. And some northeastern people used to put an onion on there to roast. So, you know, you could use it however you want. It's your kind of means of getting tea on the go, which is an important part of any railwayman's life. What would it be like when it was running in normal service? Well, you wouldn't want to touch any of these. These would burn you. These would be very, very hot. And it would also be rattling and banging. So you've got that kind of banging, clattering, hissing, roaring sound at all times. It's a very different environment to the quite clinical environments of a driver experiences today. And we're very privileged that people are still prepared to go out and drive these big machines at speed on the main line. Well, what did Duddington do on that day to make this break that record? Well, he sat here ready to go, and he's got the fireman, Tommy Brace, working hard to make that fire really, really hot. Duddington has got the regulator in his hand and he's ready to set off. The one other thing that Duddington does, he's wearing a flat hat, and so the story goes, you know, he's ready to go and he turns the hat the other way round So the brim's at the back so it doesn't blow off in the wind if he's looking around. Blows the whistle. And the day starts. That record-breaking run starts. So he storms up Stoke Bank, comes out on the top and just keeps it wide open. Speed increases because it's also dropping from there on. As they're dropping down, the speed has gone up to 120 miles an hour. He doesn't know that. He knows he's going very fast. Because actually on here, the speedometer, it is fitted with a speedo. It's under the fireman's seat over there. That's the speedometer. It's actually a French device, a flamid speed recorder. And that thing's got a paper trace in it. It's like a tachograph, really. And in France, they were known as the snitch because they snitched on drivers. At 120 miles an hour, they know they've beaten the LMS. They know they're travelling very fast because actually attached to the locomotive behind is a dynamometer car, which has very accurate speedometers on it and means of measuring speed, which is what really recorded what Mallard was doing on that day in 1938. And the people from the dynamometer car were saying, well, it looks like the maximum was 125 miles an hour, but it was in the end a world record for steam locomotion, which has never been beaten. And it was delivered by a crew that really wanted to succeed. They were a very good team on the LNER. So to this day, we think of Mallard, quite rightly, as the fastest steam locomotive in the world. Thanks for watching, and join me next time when we have a good look in the dynamometer car. There are more episodes of Curator with a Camera coming, so do subscribe so you don't miss them.